Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from Stephanie Callaghan and James Dornan, MSP, will be joining us as a substitute. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 3 to 5 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is a session with the Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care. The Cabinet Secretary will also be accompanied by the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health for this agenda item. Over the summer recess, using the Your Priorities online platform, the committee invited members of the public to suggest questions they would like us to ask the Cabinet Secretary. Today's session will be an opportunity for members to put some of those questions to the Cabinet Secretary and to ask questions about the Programme for Government 2023-24, which was published last week. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for NHS Recovery, Health and Social Care, Scottish Government, Jenny Minto, Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, Scottish Government, Caroline Lamb, Chief Executive of NHS Scotland and Director General for Health and Social Care, Scottish Government, and Christine McLaughlin, Director of Public Health, also from the Scottish Government. And we will move straight to questions. Cabinet Secretary, we're all very aware of the current situation regarding COVID-19 and the variants that we're seeing emerging. I'm wondering if you could tell committee what data the government is using to maintain vigilance about COVID-19, given the rise in cases and those new variants of concern.
Good morning, Convener. Public Health Scotland are continuing to monitor the levels of COVID-19 and also testing for the new variant as well. That's largely been carried out through those who are admitted into our hospitals where they may present with symptoms. That's been used to inform our approach to how we continue to manage COVID-19. You'll be aware that the decision was made a number of months ago, in line with other parts of the UK and globally, to manage COVID-19 like any other seasonal infection. And that continues to be our approach. What we are doing, though, is we're monitoring very closely any changes to the pattern of infections and rates of infections, and that will inform any further decisions we make on any changes that we may have to make to our approach going forward. We've also continued to keep in place a range of testing arrangements. So for individuals, for example, being discharged from hospital into social care settings, we took a slightly different approach to some parts of the UK on this, to maintain a level of vigilance in place, which means that we have a level of testing that's still taking place for vulnerable categories of patients, particularly if they're going to be transferred into social care settings.
In terms of the newer variants that we're seeing, particularly the one that's causing concern just now, how is Scottish Government monitoring that?
So we're engaged, so the CMO is engaged with the other CMOs across the UK. There's work being taken forward through the genomic sequencing process, which is obviously operating at an international level. There's work being carried out to test out I don't know the full clinical details around this, which is to test out the impact of the existing vaccination programme against the new variant. And that work has been carried out at the present moment. I also understand that the vaccination producers are also monitoring it to see whether they have to make any amendments to their existing vaccines, but that's all work that's been taken forward both across the UK and globally in order to monitor the ongoing situation going forward. At this stage, we're waiting for the reports to come back on that, but there's a level of vigilance which is seeking to try to make sure that any decisions we make are on an informed evidence base.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to move to James Dornan, who's got some questions on a similar theme.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary, Minister and members of the panel. Given the continuing presence of the COVID-19 virus, what's the government's plans to address transmission and the protection of people who are particularly vulnerable, for example, in terms of ventilation requirements and clean air?
So, going back to the point I was making earlier on, the clinical advice, not just at a Scottish UK level, but at a global level, was that COVID-19 should now be managed as a seasonal infection in the way in which we manage other seasonal infections such as flu, etc. And the reason for that is because of the level of vaccinations which have now been provided at a population level, which gives us a much greater level of protection. And our intention is to continue to manage COVID-19 on that basis. If there is at some point a change in the clinical advice around that we have to take further action, then we will respond to that. But at the present moment, the clinical advice is that we should continue to manage it in the way in which we are at the present time, in the way in which we manage other seasonal infections.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just ask a couple of questions about long COVID? You'll have read in your priorities responses complaints around people with long COVID not being treated properly with regard to access to testing, best-in-class support and treatment and public awareness education. What's your response to that?
So is this in relation to people with long COVID not being having access to lack
They're
of
complaining about people with long COVID not being treated properly with regards to access to testing, best-in-class support and treatment, and public awareness education about long COVID.
Okay. Before I bring in Ms. Minto, there's a range of work that's been taken forward by boards in the delivery of the long COVID treatment pathways, which has been delivered as part of the £10 million which we've made available for long COVID services. I think it's around 9 of our health boards have now got their long COVID pathways in place, and there are around 5 of them which are still developing those pathways. So, for example, in areas such as Greater Glasgow and Clyde, they have a long COVID service which allows GPs to refer directly into them for patients to be assessed, and then for appropriate treatment options to be made available to them. What we have allowed boards to do is to design the services in a way that best reflect their local circumstances and what they believe is most appropriate for patients within their health board area. So there are a range of services available. One of the challenges, I think, has been making sure that that clinicians know that there are services available that they can refer patients into. And some of our boards have been undertaking work with colleagues across general practice to make sure that they're aware of how patients can be referred directly into these services. Some of them will also accept self-referrals from patients into their service for patients to then be assessed and for an appropriate treatment programme to be put in place. And that treatment programme is reflective of that individual's circumstances. I don't know if Ms. Minto wants to say a bit more because she leads in some of this area of work.
Yeah. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, James Dornan, for the question. During the summer, I spent some time with a supportive group providing peer support to people that are living with long COVID. And I found that incredibly helpful, and as did my officials. And we listened to the concerns that they raised there. And I think what the Cabinet Secretary has talked about and the fact that we've allowed health boards to ensure that they provide the service that are most important for their the people living in their vicinity, that was passed on to the people. But it was very helpful from my perspective to hear what they were saying. And actually next week I've got two meetings, one with Long COVID Scotland and also a round table with children and families who have been affected by long COVID. And I think that's a very important element as well to inform the work as we go forward.
Okay, thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary and Minister. Can I ask the public, I know I heard too much there about you, the public awareness education. Could you maybe give us a wee bit more detail about what you intend to do or what you are doing to make the public aware about the long COVID?
So if I can answer that, I think what I heard from those that were living with long COVID is that
does need to be more public awareness of the conditions that they are living in and living with. I had one very fit, or had been very fit, gentleman in his early 70s who used to go out walking a lot, and it now takes him over half an hour to walk half a mile. So I think there is a need for a better knowledge across the wider public about the impacts of long COVID. And I was pleased because I had officials with me at that visit, and I will in my meetings next week and the following week. So they've heard this, and I'm speaking to them about how we can improve awareness across the population about long COVID.
Thank you very much. I've just got one more question for yourself, for the Cabinet Secretary. What's your views on the suggestion that was made in your priorities that we lag well behind EU treatment regimes?
For long COVID?
Yes.
I think we're on a pathway around long COVID in helping to understand it much more effectively. So you may be aware there is quite a bit of global research now taking place around understanding the impact of long COVID and the most appropriate treatments for it. As it stands at the present moment, there is no, my understanding is there's no single solution type or treatment type that is appropriate for patients. It's very often trying to provide a holistic form of treatment. So, for example, the service which has been offered in Glasgow now, the Long COVID Pathway, has a range of different clinical inputs into it, from physiotherapy through to occupational therapy through to other psychological services, all of which are about trying to address some of the issues that can present with patients who experience long COVID. So I think it'd be fair to say we are in a within a learning environment around how we treat long COVID. And from some of the patients I've met with long COVID, the presentation of long COVID is very often variable, and their needs are very often very different as well, which is why some of our boards are looking to try and provide services in a much more holistic way, with a range of different supports that can be provided to patients, and to try to tailor that to best reflect their circumstances. So I think it'd be fair to say we're all learning more about long COVID, and that will continue to influence how we look to deliver services going forward for patients with long COVID in the future.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. Just back
thanks,
on
James,
the
we need to move on.
Emma Harper's
got a short supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all. Just a quick supplementary. I was reading about long COVID on NHS Inform, and there's 16 different languages for people who might need support for folk to access care. Is that something that the government could consider, making sure that people of multi-ethnicity and languages know that that's available, so however, by using social media or whatever?
Thank you, Ms Harper. I think that's a very good suggestion, and I'll take that away.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I've heard some heartbreaking stories from long COVID kids, 11-year-olds with long COVID, unable to get out of bed, asking their parents if this is all that their life is going to be, and saying it's just not worth continuing. What would you say to this child and family, and what tangible help will be put in place, have you put in place, for kids with long COVID?
So I think we previously discussed this very issue about the service of long, providing the services around long COVID, and some of the pilots that have been taking place in England, and how some of that could help to inform our learning here in Scotland, which I know that some health boards have looked at and learned from. So, for example, in areas such as NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, they have been using some of the long COVID funding to bring in paediatric occupational therapists to work specifically with children who are experiencing long COVID, and also where necessary, using paediatric physiotherapists as well to help to support children with long COVID. So health boards are trying to adapt their services to make sure that where there are young people who are experiencing long COVID, that they've access to clinical teams that can provide them with the support that they require. And they're using some of the COVID funding in order to try to help to design that. So the service which they now have in Greater Glasgow and Clyde, for example, has got some paediatric services within it to help to try and address the needs specifically of young people with COVID. But you know, if there's an individual case that you want me to have looked into and you want to share those details with me afterwards, more than happy to do that on behalf of the family. But long COVID doesn't just affect adults, it affects children as well, and services are being designed in a way to try to make sure that we meet the needs of young people as well.
Thank you. And you're right, it does. And so have the Scottish Government made any assessment of the economic impact of long COVID?
Well, it's a very difficult thing to do in terms of knowing the numbers of people who have long COVID. So, for example, some of the patients that I've met with who are experiencing long COVID, some of them it's had a detrimental impact on their employment. So where they've had to, in some cases, had to give up at their employment, they're no longer able to continue with the job that they were in. Others have actually been able to adapt their working environment in order to accommodate the issues that they now have with long COVID, and others have been able to continue with their employment. So there is a variable nature of it, but at this stage I couldn't give you a figure in terms of its economic impact, and we haven't carried out an assessment to do so. Again, it will have an impact on individuals in different ways, and also it's dependent on employers being prepared to make what they should do is make reasonable adaptations for employees that have a long-term condition to allow them to continue with their employment. And it's important employers do that where that's necessary.
Thank you. And very briefly, Cabinet Secretary, there are health boards that have not got a long COVID pathway in place. When would you expect that to happen, and will you be putting pressure on Health Board to actually come up with them quickly?
Yeah, so the majority of them have pathways in place now. Those that don't are carrying out that work at the present time, and I would expect those pathways to be in place this year. So the funding's been made available for them this year as part of the £10 million programme, so there is no reason for them not to do so, and we'll continue to monitor them and the progress they're making around that.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Around NHS recovery, why haven't waiting times returned to pre-pandemic levels, Cabinet Secretary?
Well, there's a big part of that is because we are having to deal with the backlog that's built up during the course of the pandemic. So you'll be aware that during the course of the pandemic, a lot of our elective procedures, diagnostic procedures, had to be stopped, which has resulted in a significant backlog. But we're having to manage that backlog within existing capacity. So as new people add on to the list, we're also dealing with the people who were previously on the list as well. So that accumulation has made it extremely challenging. It will take some time to recover to the pre-pandemic levels. The other part that's added to this is that in some areas the levels of referrals have increased quite markedly. So, for example, in our cancer pathways, we have saw a very significant increase in the number of referrals into our cancer pathways, which are way above what they were at a pre-pandemic level. I think in some areas there's been an increase of almost 45%. Of an increase. So we're not only having to deal with the backlog, but in some areas we're also dealing with a very significant increase in the number of referrals into these diagnostic pathways as well, which is having an impact on waiting times overall. You'll be aware that boards are making steady progress, particularly around long waits. We saw a steady decline in both outpatient and inpatient long waits. And we're continuing to work with boards in order to continue to make progress with that. But it will take some time for us to be able to get back to pre-pandemic levels. The other thing I would just add to this is that we're also working through the Centre for Sustainable Delivery is in a programme of work to try to make sure we're maximising capacity within our services at the present time. So, for example, they are carrying out work and looking at, for example, the use of theatre times to look to see how we can make sure we're maximising that. We're using a new digital tool to help to maximise that, which could give us up to potentially an additional 30% capacity. And we're trying to, through the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, trying to get consistency across boards and how they maximise capacity within their existing services. So some of them are not operating at the capacity they had pre-pandemic, and we need to make sure we get greater efficiency in there as well to try to maximise use of those resources. So that combination, the history of it, and also increased referral rates, and also trying to make sure we maximise the capacity we've got within the existing system to use it to its full potential.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. Around national treatment centres, what impact are they having on waiting times for orthopaedic and cataract operations? And what impact are they having on unscheduled care and patient flow in secondary care?
Well, the national treatment centres, so for example, there's one in your own health board area in Fife, which is helping to deliver what will be ongoing improvements in the delivery of orthopaedic and ophthalmology services, which will help to reduce the waits that people have got. I don't know the exact data for Fife, but I know in Highland, I think they're ahead of schedule in terms of their programme there, and also that they are it's helping to reduce waits for patients within their own health board area. That will also help to support NHS Grampian, because patients from NHS Grampian will go to Highland NTC as well. And also, once we bring on phase two of the NTC, the Golden Jubilee, and the fourth NTC at Forth Valley, that will give us additional capacity again on that. So it's... in those individual board areas, it will help to reduce waiting times, but it's within the wider context of that increasing demand we're facing. In terms of how the impact that has on unscheduled care, etc., well, one of the challenges you always have is that acute priorities can very often displace elective at work. And the benefit of having NTCs is it's a protected environment, so it is there for elective purposes. So it gives greater certainty around the level of elective work that can be taken forward in a way that can be buffeted around within the general setting of acute priorities, unscheduled work having to take priority over elective procedures, purely for clinical reasons. So it gives us that level of protection in the system, which assists boards with their planning much more effectively. Over the course of not just within months, but within over the course of a year, because it's a protected environment.
Are national treatment centres being considered for any other specific areas like cancer treatment, which would be part of transforming cancer care?
So our plan is, I think it was overall, was to have 10 NTCs across the country. On that, we are moving towards phase two of that. That's obviously being considered within our capital programme, which is being reviewed at the present time because of the cut to our capital budget. It is primarily focused on elective-type procedures rather than acute care in itself. I don't know off the top of my head if there was anything considered, you know, Caroline, can see if there was anything considered around cancer is for NTCs, but it was predominantly around orthopaedics, ophthalmology, endoscopies and stuff like that as well in some cases.
So the National Treatment Centre programme was very much designed to deliver against that elective care. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, the importance of that is being able to separate that out from unscheduled care so that the elective care doesn't get impacted when there is real pressure on unscheduled care. In relation to cancer, so we have introduced a number of early assessment centres for cancer that bring together sort of rapid assessment and treatment centres. So that's been the focus that we've been taking around cancer.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Social care staff are set to benefit from a pay uplift to £12 per hour. This will mean an increase of more than £2,000 a year for some staff. What difference do you anticipate that this is going to make?
Well, look, you know, our social care staff are critical to helping to support and sustain our health and social care system. They are interlinked and key to one another. Traditionally, the social care setting has been undervalued, and that's reflected in the rate of pay within social care compared to healthcare. So we have taken forward a programme of work which is to try to help to make social care a more attractive environment for people to work, and to also reflect the value that we have for our social care staff, which has resulted in an increase in their pay. So with the increase to £12 an hour over the course of the last 2 years, that's equivalent of, from what we've already put in, to take it up to £10.90. That's the equivalent of over 14% of an increase in 2 years for the sector. And the objective behind this is to make it better for attracting people into it as a profession, and also to help to support retention of staff within social care in order to give it more resilience going forward. So the principal objective is to try and get more people into it, and also to help to support and encourage those that are in it to remain within it as well in the future by providing them with greater pay.
Thank you for that. The Scottish Government have avoided NHS strikes through negotiation of pay deals for NHS staff, trainee doctors and trainee dentists. I think Scotland is the only UK country that has avoided strikes thus far, which I think is good news. How will this help the Scottish NHS, and how will this help the Scottish people?
Well, look, any form of industrial action within our NHS is hugely disruptive. It's not just disruptive to the staff or the processes of managing NHS. It's hugely disruptive to patients. We only have to look at the experience in England in particular, where there has been repeated industrial action, where I believe they're in course to, there's something like over 7.5 million patients now on waiting lists, but also they're close to almost 1 million procedures and appointments being cancelled as a result. Now, that's the immediate impact. That will have an accumulative impact going forward because it backlogs things into the system. So so that's Jacot, that's the immediate impact it has. The other aspect around industrial action, and also persistent industrial action, is it demoralises staff. Staff end up feeling undervalued. It's a system which is already under enormous pressure. Staff are under enormous pressure. And adding industrial action into that, in my view, would just demoralise staff even further and make them feel undervalued, and all of the consequent challenges that go with that. So, for example, my dealing with the junior doctors is that I acknowledged and recognised the real challenges that there were around junior doctors over pay erosion, and we managed to negotiate an agreement to avoid industrial action with them on that. But my big concern is that industrial action not only is disruptive to patients, but it also just serves to demoralise people who work within the system even further, and all of the consequent challenges that then go with that going forward, and people being put off working within the NHS as a result of the disruption and the difficulties that go alongside that. So that was there's a monetary cost to settling these matters, but I actually believe that we would create even bigger challenges for ourselves if we did not try to address these issues. And the challenges that would come from having industrial action would be even greater and worse than it would be in trying to deal with some of the financial challenges that go with the pay negotiations that we've had.
Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Tess White.
Thank you. I've got three questions, if I may.
convener for the Cabinet Secretary. So my first question, Cabinet Secretary, is the chair of the BMA has said that Scotland needs 2,000 GPs, and yet you're struggling to actually find 800. So my question is, how are you going to deliver the primary care services that patients deserve in Scotland?
So if I can just correct you, first of all, we're not struggling to find 800. So we're actually ahead of trajectory on 800. So we also in recruiting into GP speciality, I think this year we were actually, we're not only at 100%, I think we were actually over applied to for GP speciality training as well. So we are in a strong position in delivering on the 800 commitment that we made in the course of this parliamentary term, and also in increasing the number of GPs in training, where we are, where all speciality options have been taken up this year as well. In order to add into that, we've also been expanding medical training. So we have given a commitment to increase the number of medical students within Scottish medical schools by 500. So this year that's expanded by, we've now expanded by 300, and we're on target to increase it by another 200. Believe it or not, the BMA have asked us to slow down a bit in this issue, to make sure there's capacity for training within the system as well for medical students. Look, there are challenges within our medical workforce. I wouldn't want to give people the impression there aren't, but I think it'd be wrong to give the impression that we are struggling, because we have been able to recruit into the offers that we've made available for general practice and also into the training programmes as well. But we need to continue to do more, because general practice is under huge pressure. And a big part of that is not just the GP workforce, but it's also the multidisciplinary team we have in primary care, because a key part of what we'll have to do in primary care in the future is to make sure that we have a broad range of healthcare professionals that can meet patients' needs in order to meet the increasing demands that primary care is going to face in the future. So that combination is going to be key to making sure we continue to try to meet those demands as best we can.
My follow-up question, Cabinet Secretary, on GPs, then it seems to be a major issue in rural healthcare, which is in crisis. So things are so bad, and we brought it up at committee last week, that the community of Braemar is trying to headhunt its own GP because the local practice has struggled to recruit a suitable candidates, and residents have actually had to take action into their own hands and do their own recruitment. In Aberdeenshire alone, five practices are now managed by the Aberdeen Health and Social Care Partnership. It's about to be six GP practices, so the wheels are definitely off the bus in the northeast and rural healthcare regarding GP practices. So two questions. Why hasn't the SNP done more to address this crisis in primary care and with GPs, and make rural Scotland more attractive for health professionals? And the second question, Cabinet Secretary, is, does the Scottish Government intend to look at the 2018 contract in the context of rural practices? Thank you.
OK, so let me try to deal with those issues in terms of rural general practice. There are challenges in rural general practice. There have been for many years challenges in rural general practice, particularly in single-handed practices in some of our rural areas, where when the GP chooses to leave or to retire, it can be difficult to recruit into these practices. That can be for a variety of different reasons. But I agree and accept there is a challenge there in some parts of rural Scotland. So what are we doing to try to address some of these things? So we've got the ScotGem programme, which is about trying to help to recruit and encourage doctors to work in rural environments. We also have the... I'm going to get this wrong. I called it the Golden Hello, but it's not the Golden Hello. It's the bursary programme, which again is to support... GPs, individuals who may be GPs working in rural areas as well, to give them financial support or a financial incentive as part of the programme. And the third thing we're doing is that you'll be aware we're setting up the Centre for Rural and Remote Healthcare, which has got a programme specifically designed to look at how we can create and deliver greater resilience within both, in particular, in primary care going forward as well, in order to try to deal with some of these systemic challenges we have in recruiting people into our rural areas. So that combination of programmes to try to help to retain and support people within rural settings, creating financial incentives through financial support for working within rural areas, again, are all programmes that are aimed at trying to support getting people into general practice within our remote and rural areas. Your point around the number of practices that are now within the NHS, this has happened historically. So over the years, some people give up their contract and they're taken over by the NHS. It happens in urban areas as well as in rural areas. But what I do know, and having just had a meeting with the Health and Social Care Partnership in Grampian yesterday, along with the chairs of the with the IGBs, is that they have a programme of work which they're taking forward in order to look at creating a much more sustainable approach to delivery of primary care within the NHS Grampian area. And that's a piece of work that they're already taking forward and expect to have that completed by the end of this year to make sure that they deal with some of the they've got a plan to deal with some of the very specific issues that they're experiencing within the NHS Grampian area in itself. So I've explained to them that I want them to look at how they can work in an innovative way using the existing system to help to try to deal with some of the particular challenges they have within their area.
But Cabinet Secretary, do you think it's acceptable that a local community has to take recruitment into their own hands to find a GP?
Well, look, the delivery of primary care within the local area and the contract is directly with the health board. I would expect the local community to engage with the health board and the health board to engage with them around how they're trying to address the issue of concern which they have to make sure there is adequate general practice services within their area. So I would expect the health board to be proactive in doing that, and if they're not, I'd be more than happy to make sure they do engage with the community in Braemar if there's a need for them to do so. But it is important that there is a level of local understanding on what's the most appropriate way to try to deliver services locally within the primary care setting.
Secretary, because there's a big difference between 800 and 2,000, and if the BMA is saying that you need to recruit 2,000 in Scotland. Do you dispute that figure?
I don't know where the 2,000 figure comes from the BMA and what analysis. I do understand that, you know, the groups of the BMA will lobby and push for what they think is the best approach. And I always engage with them in a meaningful way. And I think this afternoon I'm actually meeting with the BMA to discuss primary care in itself anyway. But look, we'll continue to look at what more we can do to try to help to support primary care, because it's a critical part of our healthcare system and will actually be under even greater demand in the years ahead, just given the demographics we have as a country and the disease burden which we face as well. So I'll always look to see whether there's more we can do, and I'll always engage with the BMA around the issues that they raise and to try to understand the rationale that comes from some of the calls that they make.
And then finally, Convener, in relation to workforce planning, I mean, it's not rocket science that you have to wait and find out that somebody's retiring. You can actually look, if we did Scotland-wide workforce planning, you'd be able to understand the flows and when people are retiring, and then know at the front end how many people you have to recruit. But in relation to the launch of the National Centre for Rural and Remote Healthcare, remote health and social care, it's months overdue. The workforce recruitment strategy has been kicked down the road until 2024. So it's good that you actually recognise that workforce planning is required, but then you're kicking down the recruitment strategy until next year.
Yeah, so I think the challenge is that people can choose to leave general practice at different points in their career. So it's not necessary. It's not always the case that they will get to retirement age and then just choose to retire. Some may choose to retire earlier. So the challenge is always trying to plan to make sure that we have the right intake into medical education, that we then have the right cohort of specialities available for people to then specialise after their foundation years, and to try to do that in a way that's reflective of what we think is the future need and demand going forward. So, the vast majority of our general practitioners are independent contractors, and they can choose to make changes in terms of the hours that they work, that they may choose to work, and also they may choose to retire at an earlier stage. So there are variables in there that we don't always control. What we have to try to do is to try and balance the system so that both training from an educational point of view into specialities is sufficient to meet what we think will be the intended needs going forward. And then at a local level, for health boards who have the direct contracts with general practice, is to be monitoring that and to try to make sure that they're putting in place the right arrangements that might be necessary should there be changes to the numbers of GPs that they have in their area, or where there's a significant increase in their population, so that they've got the right level of services to meet local demand. I think the challenge is that if we try to do everything remotely here in Edinburgh for what should happen in Grampian, we won't always get that right, and we're not necessarily as close to the community as we need to be. That's why trying to design the level of service locally is best left to local health boards to engage with local communities and to try to understand exactly what's needed locally so that they can try and design those services in the most effective way. So it's trying to balance out the system both at a national and at a local level, and to do that over the long term, which is challenging, but it's exactly what we try to do.
Carol Malkin.
Thank you. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Morning. I've got three questions around the safe staffing legislation, which has already been passed. Firstly, I would like to know, do we think that it will be implemented in the first half of next year?
That's our intention, yep. We're presently engaged with the unions in particular around this and managing it. From the discussions that have been taken forward, there's a desire, I think, on all of us to make sure it is delivered within that time frame, but to do it in a way that doesn't create unintended problems for staff within our existing NHS. And the union engagement we've had so far is very much around trying to get those balances right. I don't know if Caroline wants to say anything more on that, but it's still our intention. We're trying to make sure that we take the employee side with us to get this balance right.
And I think as part of that, this isn't about we wait until April and then we suddenly implement. So all our NHS boards are currently testing out different aspects of the legislation and the operationalisation of that, so how that actually gets put into practice. So that will provide us with some important learning. And as the Cabinet Secretary says, that's very much being done in partnership with our trade unions as well.
That's excellent. My second question was around the engagement with the trade unions, so I'm really pleased to hear that, because obviously I've been liaising with them myself. So my final question was around the link that it may have with the up-and-coming Patient Safety Commissioner's Bill. So we managed to get some amendments at stage two and think that should work together. So I'm interested to know what discussions or what thoughts you've had around that.
I'm not familiar with the amendments that you're referring to, but I'd be more than happy to take that away and have a look at what those amendments were to consider how they would work in with the say staffing levels on that. I don't know, do you want to say something that yet?
I was going to say, we've got stage three of the Patient Safety Commissioner Bill coming up in the next couple of weeks, so I think that's an opportunity there for us to take cognizance of what you've just said and look at how we incorporate that into the debate, which I'm sure you will be covering that in your speech.
Yeah, that's very helpful to know that you are still sort of committed to that. It was just the link between safe staffing and safe patient outcomes is what we want to make sure is taken forward. That's great. Thank you.
And Emma Harper has a short supplementary.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick sup on ScotGem. It's been really successful in Dumfries and Galloway. My understanding is the retention's been fab. I'm interested to know, Cabinet Secretary, whether ScotGem is unique to Scotland, and I know we've got GP issues across the four nations. So is that something that you're aware of, other of the four nations considering a ScotGem equivalent programme? Because Scotland is leading the way with this.
Yeah, it is. And I'm aware in Dumfries and Galloway they've had benefit from the ScotGem programme. It was one of the issues that I raised at the last Four Nations Health Ministers meeting, where we were discussing issues around recruitment and retention, particularly in some of our more rural areas. And I actually highlighted to them the ScotGem programme, and I've offered to share their information around how the programme operates and the benefits we've had from the programme so far with other health ministers in the UK, which I'm making available to them. So, and there was an interest in looking at how the ScotGem programme has worked.
OK, thanks.
I'm going back to Emma Harper for our next theme.
OK, thanks. So I'm interested in, one of our themes is about obesity and how do we tackle obesity. And I'm really interested in issues because of just recent questions that I've submitted in chamber regarding ultra-processed foods, as well as we call them high-fat, sugar, salt foods as well. But there's some great research by Carlos Monteiro, who's a professor of nutrition and public health in Brazil, and other books that have been quite popular recently by Chris Van Tulleken and Henry Dimbleby that talk about ultra-high processed foods and how do we, understand more about the relationship between the foods and not just sugar, fat, content as well. So I'm interested, Minister, probably as it's a public health portfolio, is around the powers that are available for us in Scotland to bring forward regulation about marketing and sales of some of these types of foods. Are you able to give us an update on work that's been taken forward?
Yeah. I'd like to thank Emma Harper for that question, and it's something that I've been having a lot of discussions over the summer with my officials. We will be doing a consultation in the autumn with regards to foods that are high in fat, sugar and salt, or salt. And we're looking at different foods to perhaps concentrate on, so for example crisps, confectionery, cakes, that kind of area, but we're consulting on this. And then we're also looking, probably going to be consulting on promotions as well, whether that's meal deals, unlimited refills, location of products in stores. So we've got all these that we're going to be looking at. I mean, I was commenting that over the summer I was shopping and I got a voucher at the end of my shop for a cake. And I was thinking, well, why couldn't have I got an option of a voucher for a banana? So it's thinking about things like that. You commented on the fact that instead of a bill, we're bringing in regulations. We believe that this will allow us to move swiftly with regards to that and efficiently. Circumstances changed, which has allowed us to bring in the regulations as opposed to a bill, but the time scales, we're working apace on them. Now, with regard to ultra processed foods, I know the two publications that you were talking about, and there's also been a number of articles in newspapers, there's also a number of podcasts about ultra processed foods. I was in a meeting just last week with Food Standards Scotland and Public Health Scotland, where I raised this as something that I would like to get a bit more information on. Currently, with regards to ultra-processed food, we look at evidence from Sacken, and currently there is no specific evidence, but and that's what the Scottish Government bases decisions and policies on evidence. But we certainly need to do further engagement and consultation on ultra-processed foods, and that's something I've asked my officials to look at.
And I'm thinking, you know, in our briefing papers, it talks about the cost of obesity. And I know that the language is changing around that. So rather than label somebody as a disease, we should be less stigmatising in the language and say it's a person living with overweight or obesity. Is that something that we should be thinking about, making sure that people understand that instead of blaming people for what may not be their own fault because of the issues around poverty and the fact that certain access to fresh fruit and veg, apparently some neighbourhoods don't have fresh fruit and veg in their local shops. So I'm interested in what work is being done to destigmatise the language around obesity as well, so that we can support people in choices of food, but also access for food as well.
I think that's a really, really important question, and actually was highlighted to me very starkly yesterday when I heard from a mother whose son was described as fat and obese, and that has given him a dreadful lack of confidence. And I think you're absolutely right. I think the whole part of language is incredibly important, and also how we work with local authorities and schools and other public bodies to ensure that that is spread out across the way that we operate in our public services. I think one example bringing it in is the Good Food Nation, and it talks about ensuring that people and children are getting the opportunity for good and healthy food. And I saw that in operation last week at a primary school in Edinburgh, where they were talking about breakfasts and healthy foods, so having your Weetabix and fresh fruit. So I think there is a whole thing about language, and I think that starts at in an education centre as well as across the general public. So something very cognisant of.
And just a final question, and the Scottish Government introducing the free school meals for primary school children and expanding that, is that something that will help tackle this, what's now being called commerciogenic malnutrition environment because of the way that the big manufacturers are targeting young folk with maybe unhealthy choices? But the free school meals that have been introduced or have been widened by the Scottish Government, that's something that should help address some of our issues that we're seeing with overweight young people as well.
Absolutely. I mean, they say a healthy start in the day is so important when it comes to breakfasts, but also with regards to free school meals as well. It is supporting families that may not be able to afford the foods that we would like them to eat. And it's really part of a whole policy within the Scottish Government of transforming the food environment, and also, as you will know, recognising that we need to bring people out of poverty, mm-hmm. to improve the general health of the population.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I think we all agree that with the right policies we could have childhood obesity in Scotland by 2030. So I really would like to understand why we've gone into another consultation process, you know, and why we can, with the evidence that we have, look at regulation. Or in fact, I would be interested to know whether there was pressures put on yourself or government to not go for primary legislation in this case, because we know that we could change the outcomes for such a large number of the population in the future.
So there was no pressure put on us from other organisations not to bring in a bill and then an act. It was through a change in circumstances and evidence from England that allowed us to bring in regulations
or via regulations. However, when we're bringing in anything to do with food, there has to be proper and robust consultation, and that's what we're doing just now to ensure that we are bringing in the right policies, evidenced policies, which will improve the ability for people to buy the right food.
And can I ask, you know, as time sensitive, this has gone on for a number of years. Can you make a commitment that you will make sure this is at the top priority for the government in terms of any business that goes through?
This is certainly a priority, and it sits in my portfolio, and it is a portfolio priority, clearly sitting under public health. And I think from my own perspective, understanding from the education side and seeing the joy on some children's faces that perhaps hadn't tried different fruits is really clear. And I think that's why it's important to work with education, also work in to ensure that families understand the importance of food. And to be quite honest, making food a pleasure and not just something that you have when you're watching the television or whatever. But I think that's where I'm coming from. And I think, as I said, it's a huge area of just changing the food environment and also the health environment across Scotland.
Just got one tiny other question that I'm interested in, is it's around the Daily Mail. I just wondered how much commitment you think there is across Scotland in the Daily Mail, if it continues to be a priority for you.
Yeah, I was up in Elgin in the summer, and Elgin was the first place I actually came across the Daily Mail. And when I was in the health centre there, they were talking about the importance of exercise, which is of equal standing to what we actually eat. And the health centre was explaining how they are supporting families, not only in the Daily Mail, but also from babes up. I think it was basically 8 months to over 80 the people were attending the health centre to be able to get support with their fitness, whether it's simply doing the Daily Mail or actually some more physical swimming or weight training. So, yes, that's really important too.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
St. Evelyn Tweed has a very brief supplementary on this.
Thanks, Convener. Obviously, during the cost of living crisis, some people are having to eat highly processed food that probably isn't that good for them out of necessity. Mm-hmm. Now, we've seen preventative diseases like rickets. The numbers have increased. Have the Scottish Government thought about how we're going to deal with this sort of issue?
So I think it's fair to say, and I've learnt this in the portfolio, that you can never be fully confident that you have eradicated a condition or a disease. And I have very regular meetings with my officials that cover different diseases and conditions. We haven't specifically talked about rickets, so I will make sure at my next meeting that that's something that we do.
We're going to move on to our next theme, and I'll pass to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. It's reported in the press this morning that the UK Government are likely to announce a ban on disposable vapes in the coming weeks. I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to a consultation on banning these. However, while that work is underway, harm is still occurring. Many of these products are being displayed in windows and alongside sweets or on the end of aisles in full view of children and young people. I wrote to retailers asking them to proactively put these behind cover, but many declined, citing that they will comply with any legislation that comes forward. Given this, is the Scottish Government planning to use their current regulation-making powers to move quickly to put these products out of sight, particularly out of sight of children? And what other additional measures, such as plain packaging and restricting advertising, are being considered?
I'll take this. Thank you, Gillian Mackay, for the question. Yeah, it is a hugely worrying situation that we're seeing. And we've got a number of strands of work within this area. Just last week, I met at a roundtable event co-hosted with Lorna Slater, talking about the from an environmental perspective, the impact of single-use vapes. I also have a meeting on Saturday with young children, because at that meeting there was a real strength of feeling that we need to consult more with younger people about what the best thing to do is. What we're currently doing is building on regulations that are already in place and trying to make the promotion and sale of vapes to under 18s, making that really reviewing that to ensure we've got the right processes in place. We consulted, I think, in 2022 on the restrictions on advertising and promotions, and we're looking at that as well just now. But there is very much ongoing work, and I'm working closely with my officials to ensure that we have the proportionate and right response to the current situation with regards to vapes.
So from that answer, is there work underway, particularly about putting them behind cover, similarly to the way we do with cigarettes currently? That's one of the biggest concerns that we're hearing from parents, is the pervasiveness of these products, particularly in shops. They can be reached by toddlers on ends of aisles in some shops. And if that was cigarettes, we'd rightly be outraged. It's the same addictive ingredient that is in these products too. So is there consideration being given to put them behind cover?
So as you'll know, we've got the Tobacco Action Plan, which will be coming out in the autumn this year, and it absolutely is looking at vapes and where they are in shops. I too, like you, have had the stories, the experiences of mothers in supermarkets with vapes at the eye level for children and the bright colours which attracts them. So, yeah, very, very aware of that situation, and it will be covered in the Tobacco Action Plan.
I hosted a roundtable yesterday that was attended by Emma Harper and other colleagues as well, and we heard from paediatricians and parents who are concerned about the addiction children are currently suffering and the potential long-term health impacts. We've never needed large-scale nicotine cessation for children before, but that is potentially looming, and many of the nicotine replacement therapies that we currently have are only licensed for children aged 12 and over. And we've anecdotally heard children as young as 8 using vapes who may need support. What work is currently underway to develop pathways and support advice for young people and parents who are facing this addiction?
So thank you for that question. I'd be really interested to get the readout of the meeting that you chaired yesterday. So there's quite a bit in that. I think one of the things ideally would be through prescriptions, but currently there are no products with regards to this that are approved by the MHRA. But that is something that we are looking into, and I'm working with my officials in pharmacy and such like with regards to that.
Thanks, Kamina.
Sandish Gulhani.
Thank you. So I've got a question around alcohol. The Turning Point 218 service in Glasgow, which helps support female offenders to rebuild their lives after drug and alcohol use, is facing £850,000 in cuts. The 218 service is primarily funded by the Scottish Government. Can you explain the rationale for cutting this service, and can you commit to restoring funding for this vital service?
So I know the 218 service from my time in justice. It's not something that's funded by health. If I recall correctly, it's funded through the Community Justice Programme directly. I know that the Justice Secretary has been engaged, and if I recall correctly, I think in Parliament it was raised, and she was said that she'd engaged with the matter, but it was in relation to community justice funding, which was having an impact. But Christine can say a bit more about that.
Yeah, I can't fully answer your question. We can follow up with detail, but there have been previously discussions about turning point as an organisation, but as Cabinet Secretary says, the majority of the funding is through justice. There's a small proportion in relation to alcohol and drugs services, as you say. So I think something that we can take away and provide a response on that for you as part of the understanding of what its budget is compared to where it's been and for what services.
Thank you very much. And just to follow up on what Gillian was asking about vaping, my real concern, a huge concern, is the number of kids that are vaping and openly vaping. It's not sort of behind the bike sheds having a cigarette, but it is walking down the street, it is in schools, they're in the toilets, and it's like a vaping toilet, and then they hide the vapes and the lights, which is hugely worrying. So I know you said that work is underway, but when are we going to hear about things that we can put into place concretely to stop under-18s from buying vapes? And look, it is illegal already, but trading standards just can't cope. So which really needs something to be done here.
I think that's a fair point. And when I was visiting one of the schools in my constituency, one of the teachers came out, and in her hand were 8 brightly coloured vapes. And so I absolutely agree that it is a very difficult situation that we're in. As you've rightly pointed out, it is illegal already to sell vapes to under 18s. And that's something we've been discussing with our local authorities to ensure that they are recognising that where possible. But as I mentioned to Ms Mackay, we have the Tobacco Action Plan coming out this year.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you very much, convener, and thank you to all for attending today. There has been a lot of correspondence, certainly from members of the public, and our call for feedback on the state of the National Health and Social Care System on mental health in Scotland, and in particular, the waiting times for CAM services. The last quarter's waiting times data shows that 73.8% of children and young people were seen by CAMs within 18 weeks. That is lower than the previous quarter and falls short of the Scottish Government target for 90% of people to be seen within 18 weeks. I understand the delivery plan for the mental health strategy will look at when boards can reach the waiting standard, but will that plan be accompanied with funding so that health boards can build the required capacity to meet that target effectively?
So, look, our CAM services have expanded enormously over a number of years, but demand for them has increased significantly as well. And I recognise the concerns that Paul Sweeney's raising around the unnecessary waits that children and families are waiting to access some of these services. So the intention behind the delivery plan that we are going to take forward is to try to help to make sure that there's a much more consistent approach to how services are being delivered across the country. You'll be aware that some boards are performing better than others around service delivery, but there's a need to try and achieve greater consistency. I can't give a commitment on the funding aspect at this stage because obviously when we get into the budget round for next year, we need to see what the budget settlement is as well. But the need to make sure that we continue to expand and develop our CAM services is a priority for us. And I know that Marie Todd, the Minister for Mental Health, spends a lot of time trying to make sure that we are taking forward the right approach to get a greater consistency of service delivery across the country, because variation is one of the biggest challenges which we face around CAM services. And the objective behind taking forward the delivery plan is to try to help to make sure we get a greater consistency of approach. Okay.
Could you tell us a bit more about the mechanisms you're actually looking to deploy to ensure greater consistency and to reduce variation? What operational changes do you propose to make specifically? And also, just on the point, I recognise that there is an ability for you to commit to specific funding at this stage, given that's not necessarily in your gift as Cabinet Secretary alone. But there is that broader objective that to allocate at least 10% of expenditure to mental health is set out in both your party's manifesto and in the group, the Bute House Agreement. Is that still the target by the end of this Parliament? Or, will there be a commitment to it, that 10% target? Or will there still be a proposed cut in real terms to the mental health budget?
So in relation to your latter point there, it is still our objective to get to that 10% within this parliamentary session and to take that forward over the course of the next 3 years. In relation to the specifics you're asked, I don't have those to hand, but I'd be more than happy to come back to the committee to give you some more detail around some of the specific measures that we are looking to take to try to address some of the issues around consistency of service provision. Thanks very much.
Before I ask this question, I'll declare an interest in that I'm registered mental health nurse with current NMC registration. I was also the Minister at the time that commissioned this review. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what recommendations from the Mental Health Law Review that Scottish Government will be taking forward, and is he able to give a time frame on that, and what work is currently underway in terms of reviewing mental health legislation?
So there was a range of recommendations made by John Scott in his report. I think we accepted all of the key recommendations that were set out within his report. Some of them will require primary legislation changes, and we are aiming to take forward primary legislation, hopefully within this parliamentary session, in order to give effect to some of the primary legislation that will be needed to implement the recommendations from it.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Emma Harper.
I think someone else was going to kick off on this one.
All right, okay. Paul Sweeney.
Thanks very much. Also want to really pick up on the recruitment crisis in social care, another major issue that's been fed back very strongly to the committee. The programme for government included a commitment to a pay rise of £12 per hour for social care staff. And if the government had acted when those calls for the £12 per hour pay rise were made 3 years ago, that increase would now be worth almost £14 per hour after inflation. Does the Cabinet Secretary think that this is sufficient to address the scale of the recruitment and retention issues in social care, bearing in mind the opportunity cost of not acting?
No, it won't. It's one aspect. So part of the challenge we've had around social care is because the reality is that we as a society have not valued it as much as we have other professional groups, particularly comparing it to health. That's a wider societal issue that we have to be honest and open about. And the consequences of that are now very clear, given the challenges that we face in social care. So pay is one part of it. The other aspect I think that's really important in social care is to see it as a career of choice for people, so that there is a career pathway, there's a progression in social care, that there's opportunities that come from that. So one of the areas that we are looking at is to see whether there's more we could do to try to help to create career pathways in social care that encourage people to go into it, to build up experience within it, and to have the opportunity to go into other professional groupings. So, for example, one of the areas of what we're looking at is there a way in which, through things like the nursing apprenticeship model, for example, that we can create pathways into regulated professions that, having extensive experience in social care, allows you to progress into some of the regulated professions through a different route from what's available at the present moment. And I think trying to create those sort of career pathways are actually critical to encouraging people to go into social care. So pay is one part of it, but it has to be a credible career option for people. And there's a lot more we need to do around that. And some of the work we're doing is to try to give some very specific routes that would encourage people going into social care with a route into other professional groupings if they choose to do so at some point in the future.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. It certainly was fed back very strongly by the Royal College of Nursing, and the nurses in training felt really that they weren't able to continue with their studies because of the financial costs to themselves, and that potential apprenticeship-led model where there's an employee status at the outset would certainly be a way of remedying that. But one of the other major issues that's been fed back certainly was the abolition of non-residential care charges. That certainly came back very strongly from stakeholders. Non-residential care charges are not only still in place, but in Glasgow they're almost doubling in cost. There wasn't any mention of care charges in the programme for government, despite the strain of the cost of living crisis and the impact that's having on some very vulnerable people. Is ending non-residential care charges still a priority for the Scottish Government, or is it not something that's on the radar at the moment?
No, it's still a priority for us, but it's a challenging area of policy for us to take forward in the existing financial climate. So our options and being able to make more progress in this are largely limited because of financial consequences with it, and not being in a budgetary position where we could actually advance it. So it's still a priority. Should finances become available to allow us to do so, then we will progress it. But at the present moment, we don't have financial provision to be able to take it forward.
Disappointing.
Thanks, Convener. I'm interested, I guess before I ask my question, I was one of those social care workers who worked in a care home and then progressed to do nurse training and became a nurse for 30 years. So I think the opportunities for career progression is something we should absolutely pursue. And the National Care Service aimed, as we were progressing with the plan, was to have a national kind of standard approach to providing education for caregivers. Is that something that we would see as we progress with the National Care Service? Doesn't matter where you are in the country, you're provided the same level of education, which would allow you to be more mobile in a career pathway.
Yeah, it is, and it's one of the potential benefits you get from a National Care Service is it allows you to create a more consistent pathway, both of training and also in career options for individuals within the social care setting, and the opportunity to move around the system in a way that they might not be able to do at the present time. Part of the challenge within social care is that it's a very fragmented sector. You've got public sector provision, you've got voluntary sector provision, and you've got independent sector provision, and they can very often all, despite the fact that there are national standards in terms of care delivery, but they can all have variations in how they actually operate. One of the benefits we get from a National Care Service is to try and get a more consistent approach across those three areas, which can help staff around training and also potential career routes as well. So the fractured nature of the way in which the social care system operates at the present time is one of the core purposes behind the National Care Service, and I think that can help to deliver much greater consistency across the country.
Mm-hmm. And just a question on the Independent Living Fund. In the programme for government, there was an announcement about reopening of the Independent Living Fund. Are you able to speak a wee bit about that?
Yeah, I'm particularly pleased to see this reopening, because I was when I was the Minister for Public Health, I set up the Independent Living Fund. So when it was being closed down at a UK level, I chose to establish an ILF here in Scotland specifically. So our ability to reopen it, which will have a budget, initial budget provision next financial year of £9 million, will enable us to open it up to around 1,000 additional disabled people who very often got much more complex needs. One of the real strengths of the Independent Living Fund is that it gives individuals much more control, particularly those who've got complex care, much more control over how their care arrangements are delivered, and by who as well. And so I'm particularly pleased we're able to reopen it for new people to apply to it. We're now taking forward the work that will be necessary with the Independent Living Fund to put arrangements in place around opening it up for individuals next financial year.
Okay. And you mentioned the third sector as part of, or the voluntary sector as part of, the complexity in provision of care. And we speak often at this committee about third sector and as it relates to social prescribing, for instance. Are you able to tell us about how the government plans to ensure the viability of the third sector agencies and support, because they're quite important to social care in the whole provision of care services for people?
Yeah, well, some of the additional finance we're making, for example, for increasing pay rates will obviously benefit those organisations from within the voluntary sector. So for the payment of their staff, I think if we can help to both retain and recruit into social care, all parts of it will benefit from that. Independent, voluntary and the public sector. We need to make it an attractive career environment for individuals, and the rate of pay needs to reflect that as well. Would I like to go further in terms of pay within social care? Absolutely. However, we have to operate within the financial environment which we have. And the reality is that £12 an hour is a significant uplift, but to go beyond that would create a significant challenge financially across the portfolio. So it's got to be an attractive environment for people, and pay is one aspect of it. And the other bits I mentioned to Paul Sweeney around creating good career pathways are critical as well. Like your own career pathway are critical to not just supporting social care, but also how it relates into healthcare going forward.
Mm-hmm. Do you have time for a quick question about palliative care? Or?
Well, no, we've got several other members who want to ask questions. So I'm going to move to Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to quickly pick up on the work done by the COVID-19 Recovery Inquiry into dentistry in Scotland, because it is an area of concern from a number of stakeholders. The British Dental Association have said that there remains uncertainty over whether the Scottish Government reform proposals will be enough to halt the exodus of dentists from NHS services. Certainly from personal experience, for the first time ever, my check-up was cancelled because the permanent dentist left the practice and relying on locums to cover it. So what are the Scottish Government doing to take forward the recommendations made by the COVID-19 Recovery Committee's NHS Dental Services Inquiry, particularly around consideration and costing of different service model options?
Thank you, Paul Sweeney, for that question, and I'll take this. I think we were very clear as well that payment reform was the first step on the journey to looking at dentistry, and we've got further work that we will be working with the BDA on, and more widely other dentists as well, on governance and workforce. I have asked for, and we're arranging a meeting with the other four nations with regards to dentistry, because this isn't just a Scotland only issue. There are issues across the whole of the UK with regard to dentistry, and part of that is as a result of a loss of new dentists coming in for two reasons. One, the pandemic. We lost a whole year, which was about 160 student dentists, but then also Brexit and how we can actually encourage dentists from across the world really to come into the UK and Scotland. So there's a lot of work happening with regards to that. This year I'm pleased to say that there are 183 or 84 students studying dentistry, so that will help move on. There's also been a lot of work with regards to working with the directors of dentistry in each of the health boards to find ways of within their specific areas to support dentistry coming in, specifically in the rural health boards as well, where, similar to what we were talking about earlier, GPs, attracting GPs, so there's work to attract dentists as well. So I think all that's incredibly positive work, and work that myself and my officials are engaging with dentists to take forward.
Thank you. A constituent of mine, Stuart McGraw, is a dentist who lost his associate during COVID. And so he stepped up to more than double his work to serve his community and his patients. But the funding did not recognise this individual case because it is individual. And it's meant that he's had to move in with his parents to try to keep his practice afloat. Now, is this something that you'd be willing to look at and help?
If you want to write to me directly, very happy to look into the circumstances of that. I mean, as you know, there are a number of funding streams that the Scottish Government has to support dentistry, whether it's grants to set up new practices or to employ additional people. But that's down to a health board level. So, but very happy if you want to write to me to look into this.
Thank you. And my second question, I visited Postal Pharmacy, and they're investing in technology to benefit patients. So they've got automated dispensing machines to allow out-of-hours collections. They've invested in a robot to help create blister packs, because lots of patients are unable to get help when it comes to blister packs now. But obviously, it's very expensive for them to do this. But it significantly helps the local community. Would the Scottish Government be able to make money available to help pharmacies that want to invest in these technologies for their communities? And could you create an environment where single pharmacies could group together to do something like this?
I visited a pharmacy as well in Ellen and saw very similar pieces of improved technology that you saw in the one that you visited. And I think what I was really struck with is the importance of community pharmacies within the community. And when I was there, I don't actually think there was a minute where there wasn't actually somebody in the pharmacy. And that discussion kind of broadened out to various areas that you have touched upon in your question. So I'm speaking to officials about ways that we can support and work with community pharmacies, because I think it goes without saying the work that they did throughout the pandemic really helped local communities, and that work is continuing. And it gives an opportunity for people in the communities to have a much closer interaction and sometimes a more relaxed interaction with healthcare. And I think that's incredibly important.
Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Just coming back to the National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare, I think it's going to be commencing next month, I think, those announcements. And obviously in my South Scotland region, it's pretty rural and remote, all the way to Stranraer, for instance. So I'm interested in where are we with that as far as, ready for an announcement next month?
Yeah, so it was announced last week. So the centre is going to be taken forward by NES, and in the first 2 years of the programme will focus on primary care. So given some of the specific challenges we have in rural areas around the delivery of primary care and sustainability of primary care, as has been raised this morning by Tess White. So that's going to be its initial priority, and it will start that work as of October next month.
Okay, and just a final quick one. Midwifery is obviously an issue that you'll be aware of in Dumfries and Galloway as well. So will the remote and rural healthcare will include midwifery approaches as well?
Yeah, it's not going to be. It's going to take quite a holistic approach to how it looks at some of the chanced around the delivery of healthcare in remote and rural areas. So, and to help to inform the approach that we should take to try and address some of these challenges. So that would include areas such as midwifery as part of its programme. Yeah. So, but particularly in your own constituency area, I can see that there are is an area which I think the centre will be able to actually work with the local board and also the different clinical groupings there to try to help to look at addressing some of the challenges which they face.
Okay, thank you.
And Sandish Kohani wanted to come back.
Thank you, Convener. As the Cabinet Secretary, just wanted to declare my interest as a practising NHS GP.
And final question from Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. So, Cabinet Secretary, cancer waiting times are at their worst level. We've got 800,000 people waiting for treatment. CAMHS and A&E waiting times are way off your own target. We've got the one-year wait for outpatients are ongoing. Agency staff costs have quadrupled due to the high NHS turnover. There's a new variant of COVID. You've brought forward the flu vaccination programme. So my question is, can we expect the worst winter for the NHS this year?
So, look, you'll be aware that we're taking forward, as I mentioned earlier on, a programme of work in order to tackle the backlog and waiting lists, and we can see across a range of different specialities very significant positive progress has been made. And we're working with Bowles to help to support and sustain that. We are experiencing within our healthcare system challenges around recruitment of staff in the same way that the health system across the whole of the UK is experiencing real difficulties. Particularly in some specialities. Some of the specialities aren't actually just difficulties for the UK, they're global challenges because of just a lack of specialists in those areas. But we are taking forward. So, for example, in terms of recruitment, our speciality recruitment programme this year, we're at 93% in terms of fill rate. We are at higher fill rate at this point in the cycle than we've ever been previously. So we've got another fill rate to go to, I think it's November it'll be finalised. So we're making very good progress in being being an attractive location for clinicians to come and train and support. Our NHS, though, this winter will experience very significant challenges. So what are we doing to try to address that? So we are expanding things like hospital at home, see and treat programmes with the ambulance service. We are working closely with our boards around preparations they're putting in place for their A&E departments, who often feel the brunt of these challenges. And we have started our winter planning programme earlier than ever before. So one of the first pieces of work I commissioned when I came in was our winter programme, given the very challenging winter we've gone through. We've taken that forward on a joint basis with COSLA. We had a winter summit just a few weeks ago that brought all of the key stakeholders from across the country, from health and social care together, the decision makers as well, to look at trying to plan and manage some of these challenges which we'll face in the course of the winter. But yeah, it will be a challenging time. I'm not going to shy away from that, and I'm not going to kid on that that it won't be difficult and that things will be perfect. But we have brought forward the planning and done it on a joint basis in a way that we have never done before to try to help to mitigate some of the challenges which we face. In terms of our COVID vaccination and our flu vaccination programme, you'll be aware that we were going earlier, so some of that was already at an earlier stage anyway than other parts of the UK. What we have done is that we brought forward some of the COVID programme for those who are most vulnerable, just as a result of the new variant that is moving forward. But we were always one of the first parts of the UK moving forward with their winter vaccination programme. I got my flu vaccine just yesterday. So anyone who is entitled to the flu vaccine or the COVID vaccine, please take up the offer which is made. So we're doing what we can to plan for the winter, for the challenges which will inevitably lie ahead, and we're also trying to put in place programmes of work that deal with the large number of people who continue to wait extended periods for treatment to try to address these issues, while at the same time also deal with the recruitment challenges which we are experiencing, not just here in Scotland but across the whole of the UK, particularly in certain specialities. But so far, we have made good progress, but we still have to do a lot more.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary and Minister, for your attendance, as well as to your officials. At next week's meeting, we will begin our pre-budget scrutiny for 2024-25, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.